Lord worship.
Amen.
It's a sweet time with the Lord. Amen. It's a sweet time to usher in the presence of the Most High. Because we can't do it without Him. We can't sing, we can't preach, we can't understand the Word without the Holy Spirit. It sets the atmosphere, and it charges the atmosphere with faith. The anointing is what destroys the yokes. The anointing is the power. We're going to learn that in a minute. The anointing is the power of God. A lot of people have Jesus, but they forgot about Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. So we know that we've been, Pastor Jesse's been in a series, but I've also been in a series. Well, we're not going to treat it like a series on my part, because there's so much in the book of Revelation. But how many know that I put the stuff up here so that you can learn? How many know that a student has not learned until the teacher has taught? Amen?
Amen.
And how do students learn? By repetition. Amen. That's how we learned in Bible college. Our pastor used to always put things on the board. She'd put the Holy Land map over every single Sunday. And every time we were in Bible college, the Holy Land map would go in there. The Galilee, the Samaria, the Judea, the one I put up here before for you guys. And that's how we learn it. God in our spirit. Amen.
Amen.
So today I'm going to do a little review. And I know everybody can probably see even though above the pulpit. Amen. Everybody look up here really quick. The review starts. We started off in the book of Revelation, and I wanted to teach the book of Revelation. God had put it in my heart to share it with the body of Christ. Amen? And it starts off in Revelation chapters 1, 2, and 3. We started off with the church age. And we know that the church age was ever since Jesus ascended after his death, burial, and resurrection. Everything after that until the rapture, which the rapture has not taken place because we're still here. Amen? Everything from then in chapters 1, 2, and 3 is the church age. That whole age, that whole dispensation of time is considered the church age. Are we still living in the church age?
Yes.
Yes, amen. Are y'all awake? Yes, amen. After the church age, we went into Revelation chapter 4. And Revelation chapter 4, it starts off after this in the New Living Testament. But in the King James, it says after these things, amen, a parallel study. After what things? After these things, the church age. But also it says after what other things besides the church age? The vision. John had a vision, right? It was a revelation of Jesus Christ about God's plan for the future of mankind and the world. Amen? So we had the vision. He had a vision of the throne and God, and he had a vision of the elders. And what were the elders wearing? They were wearing robes of white. They were wearing crowns. So something had to have happened. How did they get the crowns and the robes? Obviously, they had went to the judgment seat. Amen. And what is the judgment seat? What is it called? It's called, the other word is called?
The Bema.
The Bema. And what happens there? That's where our works will be judged. Not our sins. Why? Because our sins were already judged when we received Jesus Christ in the earth. Amen. So that's what happened between Revelation 3 and Revelation chapter 4. Now, as we continue to go into this study of Revelation, and as we get deeper into the actual book, we're going to start taking it where you don't look at it as all this happened exactly in this order, beginning for the post-rapture events, which is Revelation 4 all the way to 22, okay? We're going to look at it as more, not in chronological sequence, but actually just major events so that no one gets confused, amen? So after Revelation chapter 4, then in Revelation chapter 5, we said what happened in Revelation chapter 5, it was talking about the scroll, that the Lamb takes the scroll. The Lamb takes the scroll from the Father, which the Father's handing over judgment. He's handing over power and authority to His Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. And what was on that scroll? God's plan for eternity. Hallelujah. There was writing on the front and writing on the back. How many of you still have your scrolls at home? We have art in the middle of our table, amen? And we write prayers down every time in there. We want something to take place. We're like, Lord, we need you. We need you so desperately right now. We write it on there and we wait for God to answer. Hallelujah. We do it by faith. So today's title is called The Lamb Breaks the Seals. How many of you seen movies about breaking the seals? I know there was one a long time ago that Demi Moore did. I remember just doing this lesson. Of course, I had never seen the movie since then. But if this is talking about the seals, and you're going to have the correct interpretation in the book of Revelation about the vision that continues to unfold from Jesus to John. Hallelujah. So everybody turn with me to Revelation chapter 6. Revelation chapter 6. Has the rapture taken place?
No.
Amen.
The rapture has not the rapture has not taken place. Why? Because we're still here. Who's ever seen that movie Left Behind?
Yeah.
You seen the movie Left Behind? There's a lot of truth in that movie. So we don't want to get left behind, and we're going to find out why. So Revelation chapter 6, the Lamb breaks the seals. Everybody there in Revelation 6, verse 1. So as we begin to study this chapter, church, it opens, we're going to find out that it opens with the four horsemen of the apocalypse. Who's ever heard of the four horsemen of the apocalypse?
Yeah.
The Greek word for apocalypse is apokalypsis, meaning to unfold, to unveil, to uncover. Something is about to unfold. Amen. Remember the scroll? Something's about to unfold. And then it goes on to say that in John's vision, as we study, we're going to find out that in this vision, John reveals there are four riders on four horses that will represent war, violence, famine, and death. Jesus is the one who will begin to open each seal, and as he does, church, the events of the end of human history will begin to be set in motion. What will happen? Kicking off the 7 years of the Great Tribulation. Will we be here? We hope not, right? No, we're not. None of us here are all saved and washed by the blood of Jesus. None of us are going to be here. And we're going to thank God as we begin to get into the book that we're not going to be here, because we're going to see some horrible devastation that's going to come upon the earth that the world has ever seen. So why would God allow... praise the Lord... Why would God allow something so devastating to come upon the earth? Because God is a just God. And he's going to become the righteous. Jesus is going to become the righteous ruler of the earth, right? Amen? Amen. The Great Tribulation has to take place, church. Why? Because God's going to punish unbelievers for sin and the rejection of Jesus. But let me tell you, the good news about the Great Tribulation, and we're going to find some good news, is that there's going to be a remnant that will come to the faith. And those are going to be called the tribulation saints. But because they were left behind, they won't receive that faith in Christ without great suffering and great, great sacrifice. Hallelujah. So let's start in Revelation 6, starting at verse 1. Everybody with me?
Amen.
And it goes, As I watched, the Lamb broke the first of the seven seals on the scroll. Who's the Lamb?
Jesus.
Why is he called the Lamb? Because he was the Lamb and he was the perfect sacrifice. His blood was perfect. No other sacrifice was as perfect. Amen. He was the final authority. He was the final sacrifice. And now he's called, what, the Lion? Because he's the one that's ruler, the authority, the power, the overcomer, the conqueror. Amen.
Amen.
Then I heard one of the four living beings say with a voice like thunder. What four living beings? Everybody just glance back to Revelation 4. You may not have to turn a page and go to verse 7. Who are these living beings that John is talking about here? Revelation 4, verse 7. I'm going to read that real quick to bring you up to speed. The first of these living beings was like a lion. The second was like an ox. The third had a human face. And the fourth was like an eagle in flight. Each of these living beings had six wings, and their wings were covered all over with eyes inside and out. Day after day and night, and after night, they keep on saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the one who always was, who is, and is still to come." Who is John talking about? What are these living beings? What are they called? Anybody? Angels. Thank you, Brother Danny. Are you reading the book of Revelation ahead of me? These are the angels. Amen. Okay, and then let me repeat that part. Then I heard one of the four living beings in chapter 6, verse 1, say with a voice like thunder, "Come." Now it looks like that voice is telling John to come, but no, it's John's vision, and he's seeing the angel give instruction to now what we're going to see is a horse coming. Amen? So verse 2, I looked up and saw a white horse standing there. Its rider carried a bow, and a crown was placed on his head. He rode out to win many battles and gain the victory. Let's go back to the first part of verse 2. I looked up and saw a white horse. Well, what is that? That looks like, who? Who does that look like riding on a white horse? Gee, it looks like Jesus, right? Well, let's go on and see what it says. White horse standing there. Its rider carried a bow, okay, and a crown was placed on his head. He rode out to win many battles and gain the victory. Looks like Jesus, because Jesus comes in on a white horse later on in the book of Revelation. Sounds like Jesus. acts like Jesus, smells like Jesus, but how many know that this cannot be Jesus because we're on the onset of the Great Tribulation? Amen? Let me go with the first seal. If you're writing notes, this is good for you to take down. You will learn more this Sunday than a lot of Christians will probably learn in a whole year. Amen?
Their whole life.
And their whole Christian life. Why? Because we like to teach. Amen? First seal, not because we're better than anybody, but we like to teach. We don't like to pump up the flesh around here. First seal. This is important. What happens to the first seal? Looks like Jesus, sounds like Jesus, acts like Jesus, but how many know that this is the rise of the Antichrist? How many know that the devil will try to imitate anything that Jesus can do, but the one thing he can't imitate is his presence. Hallelujah. This is the rise of the Antichrist. Will we be here?
No.
Hallelujah. Antichrist. When we see that word Antichrist, we get all scared and mystical and wow, it's Satan, it's the devil. What does anti mean? Means against. Against who? Against the Christ. What is the Christ? The anointing. The Messiah. The power. That's what that means. Hallelujah. Yeah. Against the power. Against the anointing. He's always going to be contrary to Jesus. It began when he was in the heavens, Lucifer, and he was the most beautiful angel that God created. And pride came in. He said, I can do it better than you. I'm going to do it on my own. How many know that that is pride? That's where all sin stems from. Amen. It's the fountainhead of all sin. Hallelujah. The rise of the Antichrist. He presents himself to the world as the Prince of Peace, but how many know he's the Prince of Lies? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right. So let's move on to the verse 3. So we got verse 1, rise of the Antichrist. The first seal is broken. Let's go to verse 3. When the Lamb broke the second seal, I heard the second living being say, come, talking to the horse. Then another horse appeared, and it was a red one. How many know that the red horse represents war? Hallelujah. And this was caused by the Antichrist. He starts off with peace. How many know that the Antichrist, when he comes on the scene, he's going to be likable. He's going to come in like an angel of light. He's going to come in like a snake. He's going to deceive the people. There will be strong delusion that comes upon the world. Hallelujah. It says its rider was given a mighty sword and the authority to take peace from the earth. Talking about the Antichrist. And there was war and slaughter everywhere. During the Great Tribulation, folks, there's going to be more killing and more slaughter than in any other time frame or war in history at the Great Tribulation. That's why it is good for us to be ready, to be sober, to be vigilant, to be ready for the rapture. We haven't done a teaching on the rapture in a while because maybe we need to be brought up to speed again. We need to be alert. We need to be ready, not be found sleeping. Amen? The body of Christ sometimes goes to sleep and they get complacent. And in the Bible in Revelation, I think it's 2 or 3, in the church of Laodicea, God says, I'll rather have you cold or hot, but if you are lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. What does that mean, lukewarm? Half-hearted Christian. Oh, I want to serve God, but I still want to be in the world. Hallelujah. God doesn't like half-heartedness. He frowns upon it. He says it makes his stomach sick. It's repugnant to him. It's a nasty, distasteful taste. And he frowns and he goes, oh, I can't. You're lukewarm. I can't even look at you because it makes me sick to my stomach. Amen? Amen. We don't want to cause God to get sick. Amen. We want to be a holy, walking in righteousness, trying to walk certain steps, walking in the Spirit that we may not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Living a life of repentance before him daily. Not perfect. None of us are perfect. If you miss it, what do? We repent. Get back on the firing line. Hallelujah. So we don't want to be here. We don't want to get left behind for the Great Tribulation. How many years is it going to take place from the time the rapture happens and then the 7-year tribulation begins as the seals are broken? We don't know. We don't know if it's we don't think it's going to be a long time. It could be a short time. We're gone. The church has got to be removed out of the earth. The church, all of us. And then destruction and wrath comes. We have not been appointed unto wrath. I believe it's 1 Thessalonians. Chapter 4, Thessalonians chapter 4. We have not been appointed unto wrath, but God has come to rescue us, to get us out of the way. Got to get the church out of the way. Amen?
Amen.
Woo, hallelujah. So verse 5. When the Lamb broke the third seal, I heard the third living being saying, come. I looked up. John's looking up, and he saw a black horse. How many know that the black horse represents famine, great hunger? But Pastor Delisa, I already see famine in different parts of the world. It's not even a famine that you can imagine. We're going to see what's going to happen in just a second. And it goes on to say, come, I looked up and saw a black horse, and its rider was holding a pair of scales in his hand. What are scales used for?
Balancing,
measuring. Amen. He says, I saw a scale in his hand, and I heard a voice from among the four living beings, the angel, saying, a loaf of wheat of bread or three loaves of barley will cost a day's pay. I'm going to read that part again. A loaf of wheat of bread or three loaves of barley will cost a day's pay. In the King James, it says, a measure of wheat or three measures of barley will cost a day's pay. And don't waste the olive oil and the wine. What will happen during that famine? It's going to take a whole day's pay to earn a loaf of bread. That's famine. And how many know that after war always comes what?
Famine.
How is all this caused? By the rise of the Antichrist, which is why you and I both don't want to be left behind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you, I get excited when I talk about this because there's a lot of people that take the book of Revelation, even in Hollywood, they take chunks out of it and make movies. And of course, they put the Hollywood twist, and of course, they don't do it all by scripture. But, you know, if the Bible was such a bad book, why are you making money off of it? Amen? The Bible is truth. What is the Bible? I know everybody has seen this, but I just want to write it, just for the heck of it. Bible means basic information. I won't write the whole word. Before leaving. Who's seen that? I know we've all seen that. Earth. Basic information before leaving Earth. Whenever you buy something, whenever you get something new or you get a new phone or a new computer, doesn't it come with a manual?
Yeah.
Don't you want to read the manual? And if you don't read the manual, what happens? You start making mistakes, right?
Amen.
Well, we're going to make mistakes in God. But the whole point is that this is our manual for living. As Christians, this is our foundation, the Word of God. If we kick the Word out, then we have no foundation. Hallelujah. In this church, we want to keep the word in because the word will go over you and make you clean. The word, the Lord says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall remain forever.
Amen.
And how many know that the reason you're learning all of this? Because we don't want you to be uninformed. And also, you don't want to be, what's the other word I was looking for? But basically, don't want you to be uninformed. Oh, and then it says, the Bible says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. You've got to have knowledge. Well, everybody else is thinking, there's some movies are being made on TV right now, or TV series, getting ready for the end of the world. I don't know what it's called, but I'm sure y'all have seen it on A&E or one of those things. And I see the trailers. I say, what are you getting ready for? People think we're living in the great tribulation now, in the great judgment. We're not in the day of the Lord right now. We're in the end time. We're in the last days, but the day of the Lord has not come upon the earth yet. Amen? That's what we need to know here. You all will know. There are Christians that my husband and I have encountered that tell us that we are in the Great Tribulation period. I sure hope not. Then God would be a liar. Amen? No, amen. God is not a liar. He doesn't lie. He's not a man that he should lie, nor the Son of Man that he should repent. Have he not said it, and will he not do it, and will he not make it good? He stands by his word. He is bound by his word, and he can't do anything outside of his word. Well, I don't know his will, Delisa. I don't even know what the will of God is. I don't understand him. Freeze word.
Amen. Come on.
You're not reading his word, then it's very possible that you could be leading yourself outside of his will or even outside his protection. Amen?
Amen?
We need the word inside of us. We need to be ready. It's in season and out of season. Hallelujah. So we go on to say we were in verse 6 talking about the famine, that famine always follows war. I'm going to go down to verse 7. When the Lamb broke the fourth seal, I'm going to write these up here, second seal. The second seal, and my marker's running out, which is not good. The second seal, first one was the rise of the Antichrist. The second seal is the red horse, which means war. Now we're going to read about the third seal, verse 5. When the Lamb broke the third seal, I heard the third living being. Am I back on the right one? No, I'm sorry. Verse 7, the fourth seal. When the Lamb broke the fourth seal, I heard the fourth living being saying, come. I looked up. It says, I looked up and saw a horse whose color was pale green. What does pale green represent? Death. How many of you have ever seen a corpse on television and it always looks kind of greenish yellow? This represents death. Its rider was named Death and his companion was the grave. I'm going to look up here on the third seal and I'm going to put famine on here so y'all can just, if you're writing notes, just so you can keep up or I can keep up, this famine. So we have the rise of the Antichrist, we have second seal is war, now we have the third seal means famine. And this is all the kickoff of the Great Tribulation period. So we talk about in verse 8 that the horse was now green and his rider's name was Death and his companion was the grave. This is the fourth seal. We put Death here. Yes. These two were given authority, it goes on to say, over one-fourth of the earth, watch this, to kill with the sword and famine and disease and wild animals. What fourth of the earth is John talking about? Obviously, this is not the final judgment, because if not, it would have been the entire, the whole earth, amen? The one-fourth of the earth, most of this stuff's going to take place in the vicinity of the Middle East, folks, amen. In the vicinity of Jerusalem at the beginning, amen? This is where it all going to start. Is there a war already there? Yes. So it can be confusing. Well, it's already happening. No, you haven't seen anything yet. This is cupcakes compared to what's going to go on in the Great Tribulation. Hallelujah.
Come on.
Everybody turn with me real quick because I want you to understand. We just read about the pale green horse and then the two were given authority over one-fourth of the earth to kill with the sword and famine and disease. So go with me to Matthew 24. I want you to see what Jesus said. We know what John is being revealed by Jesus in the book of Revelation, but I want you to see what Jesus said to the disciples when he was in the earth with them and when he was training them for those 3.5 years. Matthew 24. Now I want to start 24 and I want to go to verse 3. Y'all are going to love this. Y'all are going to learn something today. Now when you read the Gospels, you're going to know how to interface it with other parts of the Bible. Hallelujah. And especially when it comes to the end times, it's really good to go to the Gospels where Jesus spoke. My letters are in red. Some of yours may be in red. Some of yours may not. But he is speaking and he's speaking to the disciples. Hallelujah. Verse 3, 24 verse 3. It says, later, Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives. His disciples came to him privately and said, tell us when will this happen? Let's go back to that first part. Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives. You know what the Mount of Olives is? That's the same mountain that he's going to, when at the second coming, he's going to return to the vicinity of Jerusalem, and he's going to touch his feet on the Mount of Olives. At the second coming, not the rapture. The rapture is when he comes in the air, and we meet him in the air. The dead will rise, we put on incorruptible, we meet him in the air. That's a different event. A lot of Christians say that the rapture and the second coming is the same event, and they are liars. It cannot be. Watch what Jesus says. Later, Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives. His disciples came to him privately. Privately.
Come on
now. And said, tell us when will the... How many of you cannot share spiritual things with unspiritual people? Well, he can't share spiritual things. A lot of Christians try to share spiritual things, especially in families. They want to share all these spiritual things with family members that are not saved because they think that if they just say that one last spiritual thing, they're going to come to salvation. How many know that's not true? In some rare cases, it can be. But it's very difficult to minister to family. Don't share spiritual things or your blessings or your dreams and visions that God puts in your heart with family or friends that are not spiritual. They must be in the faith. They must have salvation to understand and at least be in God's word so that you can have a holy conversation and holy fellowship there and agreement. Amen?
Amen.
So here's Jesus telling them privately. He often did that with the disciples. Remember, he was training them. Tell us, when will this happen? What sign will signal your return? What sign will signal your return? And the end of the world. A better translation for the end of the world is the end of the age. Amen?
Amen.
People take that end of the world and this maybe this translation and other translations that may use the end of the world and they'll take it and they'll say, oh, the world's ending. No, the world as we know it, the world system as we know it, the age will end, but the world is not going anywhere. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Verse 4, Jesus told them, don't let anyone mislead you, for many will come in my name claiming I am the Messiah. That's already happening. That's already been happening. We have the David Koresh's and the people, Jim Jones, and they all have led people astray, and they all have this pact of suicide because they say the world is ending and that God told them. How many of you know that many will come in my name claiming I'm the Messiah? They will deceive many. That's happening now, and it will happen in the Great Tribulation, but to a much greater degree, because the Bible says strong delusion will be sent upon the people. I mean, many deceiving spirits in that time, and deceiving prophets will come in that time of Great Tribulation. It says, and you will hear of wars and threat of wars. We have them now, but nothing compared to what's going to happen in the Great Tribulation. But don't panic. Yet these things must take place, but the end won't follow immediately. Nation will go to war against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in many parts of the world. Whose fault is this all going to be? The Antichrist. Amen? He's going to be the originator, the founder of all this mess when he comes upon the scene. When he comes on the scene. Verse 8. But all this only will be the first of birth pangs, with more to come. Verse 9. Then you will be arrested, persecuted, and killed. There's going to be great persecution during the time of the Great Tribulation, folks. A lot of people will be killed. Now, there are people being killed and martyred. That, even now, not so much common in this country as it is in other countries. There are people being killed. How many know that a martyr is someone who dies for a cause? There was a lot of martyrs. Obviously, some of the apostles, most of the apostles became martyrs for Jesus Christ. Why? Because they were the foundational apostles. And they were going to bring Christianity throughout the entire region. Verse 9 again. Then you will be arrested, persecuted, and killed. You will be hated all over the world because you are my followers. Verse 10. How many know Jesus said that if they hated me, they're going to hate you? Amen. Verse 10. And many will turn away from me and betray and hate each other. There will be people that will be believing in God, serving God, and then they're going to turn away. Why? Because it's going to be harder to serve than it is to not during this time period. They're going to give over. Verse 11. And many false prophets will appear and will deceive many people. There's already a stage right now being set for that time frame. There's many great deception going on in the body of Christ already to deceive, to turn people away from the truth that's going on in the body of Christ right now. Perverting the gospel of grace and also goading people to get their money. Verse 11 again. And many false prophets will appear and will deceive many people. Verse 12. Sin will be rampant everywhere, and the love of many will grow cold. Verse 13, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. And the good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world so that all the nations will hear it. And then the end will come. Talking about the second coming. The Great Tribulation is the prelude to the second coming. 7 years of Great Tribulation, then boom, the second coming at the end of the Battle of Armageddon. Hallelujah. Everybody turn back with me to Revelation 6. We have first seal, the rise of the Antichrist. The Great Tribulation kicks off. The second seal is war. The third seal is famine. The fourth seal is death. Now we go on to read in verse 9. When the Lamb broke the fifth seal, I saw, I love this, under the altar, the souls of all who had been martyred for the word of God and for being faithful in their testimony. I remember what I just said, that the word martyr means someone who dies for a cause. And it goes on to say, they shouted to the Lord, O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you judge the people who belong to this world and avenge our blood for what they have done to us? I'm going to go back. The souls under the altar, there was a tabernacle in heaven, the altar in heaven, there were souls under the altar of those who were martyred for the cause of Christ. You know who those people were? Everybody from Abel, remember the Cain and Abel story? Abel was killed by his brother Cain because Cain was, his offering wasn't received the way Abel was. He became jealous, he became angry, he became proud, and he killed his brother out of a jealousy and anger. And because God received his offering, why? Because Abel's heart was different from Cain's. Cain's was a hard heart. Abel's was a demonstration of a heart of flesh, a heart that wanted to do all of God's will. He gave God his best. That was the difference. Cain killed Abel. Abel's blood cried out from the ground. Y'all remember that? When God asked him, where is your brother? He asked Cain, where is your brother? Everybody from Abel died for the cause of God. He died for the cause of truth, for standing for truth. Amen. Everybody from Abel all the way to the rapture. Obviously, there's going to be people being killed in other countries for their faith, for Christianity, all the way to the rapture. These were the people under the altar. Hallelujah. That means what? That means the rapture had to have already taken place, because these were the redeemed here. Amen. So it goes on to say, the altar, when the Lamb broke the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of all who had been martyred for the word of God, the first saints, the first prophets, all the way to the rapture, for being faithful in their testimony. They shouted to the Lord and said, O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you judge the people who belong to this world and avenge our blood for what they have done to us? How long, O Lord? Will it be before you judge sin in the earth? Sometimes Pastor Jesse and I will be driving in a car, and we'll see a prostitute on the street. We'll see her several yards away, and so far away, I could still see that around her, her face, so distraught, so lifeless, so hurt. And I say, Lord, sometimes I just cry. I say, Lord, how? By the grace of God, there go I. That could have been any one of us, but by the grace of God, here we sit today. Enjoying God's presence, enjoying the fellowship of one another, enjoying the Word of God, enjoying what God has for us, and enjoying all that He shares with us. And there she is, distraught, just depressed. I mean, you could see it from yards away. And I say, and this is the cry that they were having under the altar. How long, Lord? Sometimes I say, Lord, please, can you just come and rapture us? There's so much pain in the earth. There's so much wickedness in the earth. Can you please? There's so much hurt. There's so much anger. There's so much just disarray in the earth. That's the cry of my heart. This was the cry of the ones under the altar here, all the martyred, all the first saints and prophets that were martyred. Here they are crying out, Lord, holy and true, how long before you judge the people who belong to this world and avenge our blood for what they have done to us? You know what it sounds like there in the last part? It sounds like you're saying, get them, Lord. When are you going to get them, Lord, for what they did to us? When are you going to get my brother Cain for what he did to us, for what he did to me, Lord? No, it's talking about, I'm tired. These people were tired of the shame. They're tired of the sin in the earth. And how many know that in the Bible it does say, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. The Lord's day will come and He will avenge their blood. It goes on to say in verse 11, then a white robe was given to each of them. This represents robes of righteousness, purity. And they were told, I love this part, they were told to rest a little longer until the full number of their brothers and sisters, their fellow servants of Jesus, who were to be martyred, had joined them. Who were they resting to wait for? Obviously, the great tribute. See, they were already in heaven, so that's the redeemed up until the rapture. Amen. All the redeemed of the rapture, the ones that were raptured out of here. But he says, you got to rest a little longer and wait for your fellow brothers and sisters. Who are they talking about? These are the tribulation saints. The saints that will get saved during the great tribulation. And Jesus told them to rest a little longer until the rest come up to meet them. Hallelujah. I love that. I love that. You know what the Bible says? It says, pray for your enemies. Give them a cup of water. If someone despitefully uses you or comes against you or hurts you, and I know many of you, probably all of you, have had somebody hurt you so severely. Deep wounds, deep resentment, bitterness, anger, whichever way it came. Get them, Lord. I just want you to get them. I don't understand why you just haven't gotten them yet. How many of you know that that's your human emotion? And you'll have a season where you go through that. And when you get in God, you begin to pray that out and He'll begin to heal you. Amen. But the Bible says we're to pray for those who despitefully use us. Pray for those who persecute us. Pray for those who come against us. Amen. So I challenge you, if there's anything in your life that, or anyone that has come against you that you feel anger toward or bitterness toward, I challenge you this week, start praying for those who have despitefully used you, who have despitefully persecuted you, who have despitefully talked about you. I challenge you, pray for them this week and see what God does in your life. Amen. Amen. Let's go on to verse 12. So here they are. They cried out to Jesus. And Jesus told them to wait because the rest, there's some more coming. There's some more coming up. So just wait a little longer. Verse 12. I watched as the Lamb broke the sixth seal. And there was a great earthquake. The sun became as dark as black cloth, and the moon became as red as blood. We've seen movies about this. Then the stars of the sky fell to the earth like green figs falling from a tree shaken by a strong wind. The sky was rolled up like a scroll, and all the mountains and islands were moved from their places. Y'all ever seen the movies? You know, they have computer graphics now. They're so intense and so like technology is so advanced in movies where you see the skies, where they're showing the sky in the movie, and it's rolling up. I want you to picture that when you read this. Let's read it again. I want you to picture that sky rolling up. It says, then the stars of the sky fell to the earth like green figs falling from a tree shaken by a strong wind. The sky was rolled up like a scroll, and all of the mountains and islands were moved from their places. Everybody turn with me to Matthew 24, verse 29. Back to Matthew 24. We know that the fifth seal, as you're turning there, we just talked about the fifth seal. This is the martyrdom of the saints. That's how I wrote it here. Yes, from Abel to God. First martyrdom and saints martyrdom. That's it. Martyrdom of the saints. Y'all, Matthew 24. How many of y'all are enjoying and getting to have more understanding about this? Maybe you tried to read this in the past. Maybe you've tried to dissect and study the book of Revelation. Some of you say, well, I understand this, but I don't quite understand that. Hopefully the Holy Ghost is bringing more understanding and enlightening your spirit today, bringing all the Word of God together, and even going back to what Jesus said, and now putting it together with the book of Revelation here in Matthew 24. Amen. So Matthew, we're going to go to Matthew. Now remember, we just read about the sky rolling up. We just read about the stars falling from the sky and the earthquake and the sun becoming as dark as black cloth and the moon becoming as red as blood. And obviously something tremendous is about to happen. So now we go to Matthew 24 and 29. I'm going to go to 29. Immediately after the anguish of those days. So obviously, if you read the Bible in its complete, in its text, you'll understand and see after the anguish of those days. Well, what was the anguish? It had to be the seven-year great tribulation. So everything that you just read in chapter 24 right prior had to be talking about the great tribulation, not the rapture. Amen. Amen. Or not the rapture, as some people say, and try to put those events together. So it says, immediately after the anguish of those days, or immediately after the seven-year great tribulation, the sun will be darkened. The moon will give no light. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound familiar when Jesus is saying that? The stars will fall from the sky, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then at last, the sign that the Son of Man is coming will appear in the heavens, and there will be deep mourning among all the peoples of the earth. Go back with me to Revelation 6. Go to verse 15. Now you see how Jesus spoke. He was prophesying what was going to happen, telling the disciples what was going to happen in the end of the age. Now we're back at Revelation. Now you can look back and say, this is the same thing that Jesus was revealing to John, but this time he says, get the church ready and let's get the church raptured. Let's get them out of here. And this is what's going to happen. Revelation chapter 4 and on is post-rapture events. Everything that you read that takes place is after the rapture. Amen? So let's go to verse 15. Then everyone, the kings of the earth, the rulers, the generals, the wealthy, the powerful, and every slave and free person all hid themselves in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains. So wait a minute. This is every ruler, every general, every king, every wealthy person, every slave, every poor person, every free person all hid themselves. That means there'll be rich left behind. There'll be powerful left behind. There'll be kings. These people are here, but these are the ones that have been left behind. These are people that are not in the rapture, obviously. So here they go, all hid themselves in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains. Why? Because Jesus was about to show up on the scene. Why were they hiding themselves? How many know you can't hide from God? Amen? Amen? You think you might be able to hide this or that, but you can't hide from God. He's an all-knowing God. He's omniscient, which means all-knowing. Amen? He's an all-knowing God. And it says that these people tried to hide themselves. Why were they trying to hide themselves if Jesus was soon to return, or Jesus was returning? Isn't that supposed to be a glorious time? Yay, Jesus is coming. Oh, no, they weren't happy. Why? Because they were caught with their hands in the cookie jar. They weren't ready. These people probably had not been prepared for his return. They were living how they wanted to, dancing, you know, carrying on, drinking, just having a great time. And here's Jesus. So they're trying to hide. They're running. Verse 16. And they cried to the mountains. This is a real good revelation for you guys. And they cried to the mountains and the rocks. How many of you can't pray to mountains and rocks? Mountains and rocks isn't going to help you at the time of Jesus' return. Mountains and rocks is not going to help you when you're in a financial situation. Mountains and rocks aren't going to help you. How many of you know that's not going to help you? You got to pray to the one and only.
That's right.
Amen. Jesus, in the Bible, in James, it says, if anybody lack wisdom, let him ask of me. I won't rebuke you for asking, but you got to ask me only. Don't ask me and then everybody else and everything else. Ask me, and I will give it to you. Amen.
Right.
I will give it to you. You got to come in faith in the one who's God, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. It says, and they cried to the mountains and the rocks. Boy, they were panicking. Fall on us and hide us from the face of the one who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. They were scared because Jesus was coming and they weren't prepared. They were wanting to hide under these rocks and mountains. How many know if you abide under the shadow of the Almighty, He will protect you. You stay under the umbrella of protection, which means what? The umbrella of protection is coming to church, staying around the body of Christ, doing whatever it is with the fellow Christians. You stay under the headship or the umbrella of protection, because when you step out, that's when everything will try and come to steal your faith or contaminate it. Amen. We got to be ready. We can't be asleep.
Amen.
These people fell asleep somewhere along the road, and now they're trying to pray to the rocks, ask the rocks to help them, because they're in a desperate situation, and the king is returning. So verse 17, for the great day of their wrath has come, who is able to survive? Everybody turn back with me to Matthew 24, verse 30, and we're going to close with this verse. Matthew 24, 30. How many of you are learning something today? How many of you know that it's not worth it? Life, the world, whatever it has to offer you, the good times, the this and the that, none of that is worth it. How is that all going to prepare you for the day when Jesus comes back to your church without spot or wrinkle? I want to be ready. I want to go for the crowns at the Bema. I don't want to just barely make it into heaven. I was sharing with one of my sisters here, and I was sharing about a person that passed away, and they probably didn't have Jesus, and not sure. They said they received Jesus, but we don't know because they were consumed with alcoholism, and they were at their deathbed, and then they passed, and I was praying. I said, Lord, they're not in the city, and I said, Lord, please send somebody to minister to that person to make sure, in case there was. He received Jesus when he was in a drunken stupor or something. Maybe just send somebody. And all I know is that someone called right before they passed, and they made sure they received Jesus at their deathbed.
Amen.
Amen. Now, is that person going to get the crowns and maybe get a certain position in the future kingdom? No. Will they barely make it into heaven, sliding in as the flames are on their feet? Get the flames out. Pour the water on the feet, probably. But you know what? They'll at least get in, right? Amen. Hallelujah. How many of you know that if there's family members that you know that are at their last, maybe they're older, in their older years, maybe they're very sick, and you know they haven't received Jesus, the tenderest place you can find them is right before they pass. So that's just a word to you guys, a little nugget for you guys. Amen. 24 and 30. We're going to close with this. I know we started, but I want to finish it up and reread it again.
Amen.
And then at last, the sign that the Son of Man is coming, Perusia, will appear in the heavens, and there will be deep mourning. Hear the people again. They're mourning, and a lot of people interpret this differently, but I'm going to bring some light to it. And there will be deep mourning among all the peoples of the earth. Why? They're mourning. Oh, they're mourning because, oh, my Lord's coming. Oh, Jesus is coming. I'm in such mourning. No. They were mourning. They were trying to hide.
Sure.
They were trying to go to the mountains and hide. Why? Because they weren't ready. And it was not for them to look upon Jesus' coming was not good news for them. How many know it's good news for those who have salvation?
Amen.
It's good news for those who are walking in faith in Christ, who are in Christ, in Jesus Christ. And it goes on to say, This is, and there will be deep mourning among all the peoples of the earth. And they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. How many know that that is the second coming? He's going to return. He's going to come with all of us. We're going to return. He's going to come to judge the living nations. He's going to come to judge. Remember, we put up there a long time ago. I haven't gone to that part again because I'm starting over. But we put up where he's coming to judge the living nations. He's coming to judge the nation of Israel. Amen. His people. Hallelujah. Everybody close your Bibles.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing, but am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find.